Hello all, this is Dr. Alsop, and I can't wait to explore the fun that is the superficial veins of the anterior neck, so let's get right into it. The objectives for this video are to be able to diagram the superficial veins of the neck, and really understand where they drain their deoxygenated, or mostly deoxygenated, blood. Recall that blood has to make its way back to the heart, so how does it get there? Most of these superficial veins are heading towards a major vein of the root of the neck, and we will discuss which one that is in a bit more detail. Okay, so superficial veins are called superficial veins based on their location and relative position to the deep fascia. So we should be familiar what the deep fascia is at this point. If not, please make sure you review that lecture video. Sometimes you can see portions of the superficial veins through the skin. You don't want to see all of these superficial veins. We'll talk about why that is in a moment. But they're close enough to the skin to be able to see a little bit of that. But before we get too far in this conversation, I want to say that veins are variable. Now, I want you to say it. Veins are variable. Say it as many times as you need to get that stuck in your head. This means that there are common variations, and by common, I mean common, very common to have variations for where these veins are located, where they drain, where they form. What I and my colleagues will be teaching you are the most typical pattern, as in what you will see on the test, but sometimes this most typical pattern is only seen in, say, 40, maybe 30% of individuals, so not all that typical. Superficial veins are the most likely to have variations. Deeper veins can certainly be variable, but at lower frequencies than their superficial counterparts. The most prominent and most consistent superficial vein in the anterior lateral neck region is the external jugular vein, and I'm going to outline it here. You can see that it's a little bit on the larger side, especially in comparison to some of the other superficial veins. The vein's going to begin near the angle of the mandible, and it will cross the sternocleidomastoid, that rope-like muscle right here, obliquely in the neck. So a very important relationship there. This vein will drain regions of the scalp and the side of the face, as well as pick up tributaries in the neck region. And generally, you can see sometimes a small portion of the external jugular vein through the skin. If the whole course of the vein is visible, this is a potential indication that venous pressure has risen, which can be indication of something bad. The external jugular vein is formed by the coalescence, or the joining — you'll hear me use that word coalescence quite a bit, just means the joining together — of the posterior auricular vein right here, which is located posterior to the ear, and the posterior division of the retromandibular vein. Those two will come together to form the external jugular. You can see once again it is starting to cross over that sternocleidomastoid muscle. The EJV will most typically drain into the subclavian vein. So let's talk a bit more about that subclavian vein. The subclavian vein is a major venous channel, that drains the upper limb and portions of the upper thorax and the neck, so that's a big amount of space. It will pass anterior to the anterior scalene muscle, and you'll talk more about that with Dr. Fox in some other sessions, and it will unite with the internal jugular vein. So you can see kind of where these two are coming together. We call this region right here the venous angle. We'll talk more about why that's important in subsequent sessions. And where that internal jugular vein and the subclavian vein join, you will have the formation of the brachiocephalic vein. So you can see the brachiocephalic vein here. This is going to be the left brachiocephalic vein. The brachiocephalic veins unite to form the superior vena cava, which you can see right here. The superior vena cava will drain into the right atrium of the heart, which you can see peeking out in this region. So that is how you're getting blood returned back to the heart. The subclavian vein is often a point of entry to the venous system for central line placements, and it's used because it's fairly easy to get to. You can palpate the clavicle, you know that subclavian vein is going to be deep to that. So with these central line placements, you can administer nutritional fluids or medications, or you can even measure central venous pressure. Now, moving back to the superficial veins, let's talk a little bit about the anterior jugular, which you can see right around here. You can see one right around here, too. This vein is typically formed by the coalescence or the joining of the superficial submandibular veins, which you cannot see because they've been removed in this dissection, but they would be these super tiny vessels that are kind of in this region here, and they would kind of come together to form the anterior jugular vein. The most typical location or where you would identify an anterior jugular vein is anterior to the superficial infrahyoid muscles, particularly that sternohyoid, which will run on either side of the midline. The veins on each side will sometimes join to form a jugular arch just above the manubrium. So sometimes these two will kind of come together right about here. But as you can see with this donor, that's certainly not always the case. The anterior jugular veins either drain into the larger external jugular veins or directly into the subclavian. There are certainly other superficial veins in the anterior neck, basically kind of all over the place, but as the external jugular and to a lesser extent the anterior jugular veins are the most consistently present, these will be the only ones you will need to identify and understand specifics on. All right, let's finish with our review question. I love this question because this is an important anatomical relationship. The external jugular vein runs superficial to and obliquely across which muscle? Is it the platysma, the sternocleidomastoid, the sternohyoid, or the trapezius? As always, pause if you need to think through this. All right, the correct answer for this one is B, the good old SCM or sternocleidomastoid muscle. The platysma muscle is typically superficial to the superficial veins. It isn't, we didn't ask about the anterior jugular vein. That would make more sense with the sternohyoid because that anterior jugular is typically superficial to the sternohyoid. And it isn't the trapezius, as this is much more posteriorly placed. So the correct answer is sternocleidomastoid. All right, thank you for your attention as we have reviewed the superficial veins of the anterior neck. If you have any questions, as always, please feel free to reach out to me. Have a great day.